Hi, I'm Sarah Maurer, and in this lecture, we're going to examine what Earth looked like 4.2 to 3.8 billion years ago, and how that could relate to the origins of life. The first thing that you should know is what the geochemical landscape of early Earth looked like. And so there was definitely an ocean that was warmer than today's oceans, and that ocean was probably a little more salty than the oceans that we have on today's planet. Additionally, there were land masses that were likely formed through volcanic activity or possibly also plate tectonics, although this is not fully known yet. And on these continents, we likely had lakes and ponds that were composed of fresh water due to precipitation. The other forms of water might have existed in temporary streams that would occur from different weather events. And additionally, all of these surfaces, all of these continents, were simply composed of minerals, different types of minerals that would have been available on early Earth. And so these mineral surfaces are a great location for things like catalysis and energy generation that we don't really have today, because everything, all of the minerals on Earth now, are covered by a layer of life. The different chemical reactions that were occurring on early Earth would have been mixed through a variety of different processes. And so, similar to the things that we see on Earth today, there were likely tides, there was mixing between the ocean and the inland lakes through evaporation, aerosol particles getting sprayed into the air and floating over to a different location. We had volcanic plumes that were delivering molecules across the continent. And then you have things like hydrothermal vents and deep sea locations where a different set of chemistries can occur. And so all of this mixing would lead to a unique chemical library through a variety of different equations, different reactions that lead to a diverse set of compounds for early organisms to be generated. Origins of life scientists use these locations and build what we would sometimes refer to as a warm little pond that Darwin first proposed. And in these ponds, there is some fresh water that flows in and hydrates the existing molecules so they can react together and form complex biological molecules. Perhaps this water evaporates and causes polymerizations to occur as condensation happens. And then they get rehydrated again and encapsulated into the first cell membranes. And these first cell membranes can harbor early forms of RNA, or they can create different catalytic networks that feed off of one another. And through subsequent generations, they will evolve into the life that we see today. And where these locations occur, whether it's deep in the ocean or in volcanic craters, or here pictured as an impact crater, it's highly debated among origins of life scientists, but we do know that there was a lot of different environments on Earth where life could have evolved. The energy sources that are going to build our chemical inventory are going to come from pretty much two different places. So we have chemical energy, which is going to be in the form of reduced gases or reactive gases like H2 gas, hydrogen gas. We also had a lot of radioactive material, which could have created complex radiation, which leads to free radical formation and then interesting carbon chemistry. And then minerals could have served as an energy source because they're often great electron donors. And so redox reactions drive most of the metabolic processes that we have in extant life. The other energy sources that we see are environmental energy sources. And so those are things like lightning or ionizing radiation, or kind of constant energy sources from the environment, like a high temperature, high pressure environment in the form of hydrothermal vents. And so all of these different energy sources are invoked to create our initial chemical library. The first really good example of this was the electric discharge experiment, sometimes called the Miller-Urey experiment, named after the scientists who discovered this, that if you put an electric spark, in their case through electrodes, into a chamber that composed what we think was Earth's earliest atmosphere, shown here as methane, hydrogen, water, and ammonia, we end up getting a complex library of biomolecules, which are listed in the table. You can see that glycine is a large component of the prebiotic soup that they created. And glycine is one of our essential amino acids. And so this is a very promising mechanism for generating interesting carbon compounds. We also have alanine, aspartic acid, glutamic acid, other amino acids, and then formic acid and acetic acid, which are part of the reduced carbon library that we would use to make early metabolisms. While this version of the experiment may not be true to early Earth environments because methane was likely not available on early Earth, if you replace that methane with carbon dioxide, you get a slightly altered version of the experiment with different abundances and slightly different products. But you can still get a diverse library of chemical compounds that could have been used to create first life. The other major source of organic compounds is through interplanetary dust particles or delivery of carbon to Earth from the solar system. So when the Earth first formed 4.5 billion years ago, the solar system was still accreting. And all of these smaller particles would have been pulled into Earth by Earth's gravity. And these particles have a different chemistry and different energy sources that were available to them in space, essentially. And one of the most famous examples of this is the Murchison meteorite, which is pictured here. You can see that it had a large number of interesting carbon compounds, including amphiphiles that could form membrane structures, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, alcohols, and even some interesting aliphatic hydrocarbons that could have been metabolic components. And when looking at other carbonaceous chondrites, which is just a small fraction of the total type meteors that are delivered to Earth, we see that each meteor meteorite has a different chemical library. These chemical libraries are produced because the reactions in space are going to be dependent on the types of energy that hit that particle. And so these particles are composed of water and carbon monoxide and methane, perhaps nitrogen. And when high energy radiation, like UV radiation, hit the particles, they form free radicals, which allow for some very strange chemistries to occur. And that leads to complex carbon chemistry. Additionally, there's heat and there's gas phase bombardment and perhaps other forms of ionizing radiation that could lead to these very interesting carbon compounds. So was there really enough of these reactions to actually generate a complex chemical library that could have led to life? When we estimate how often these occurred and compile all of the different sources of carbon, we estimate that about 100 billion kilograms per year of prebiotic organic material was delivered or synthesized on Earth during this time. And so we think that there was definitely enough material to actually jumpstart life and to have abiogenesis occur.